All right, good evening, folks. Good to see you here tonight. Appreciate your faithfulness and coming back on a Wednesday night. I've had several people filling in for me, and I'm very grateful for that. But it's time to get back in the saddle again. So you should have a prayer list in front of you, and I'm going to share some prayer requests in just a bit. As far as some announcements, let's see. The WOM is meeting tomorrow at 1 o'clock. I knew if I didn't say that, I'd get in trouble. And so, ladies, remember that. Be a part of that. Great ministry within our church and keeps us informed on missions. And as I shared with you Sunday, one of the highlights of the Southern Baptist Convention is when we send out our missionaries, our international missionaries. We sent out 83 of them on that one particular day when we had the send-off. So really a neat thing to see that. And some of the individuals we were not able to even meet or see them in person, and they were just in shadows because they're going to countries that are hostile to Christianity. So there were several in that particular situation. Anyway, there is a Tuesday night together coming up on Tuesday, June 25th. They're going to go to the Silver Dollar Cafe in Collinsville, Oklahoma. And some of you say, man, that's a ways over there. It is. It's almost close to my hometown where I grew up. But I will tell you that based on the old Silver Dollar Cafes that I used to go to, if it's anything like that, you don't want to miss that. And we'll, I think by leaving at 5, we can get over there by about 6:30 and eat and then be back. And you're not interested in getting home very early anyway. So we'll make sure we get you back in time to watch the late show or something like that on TV. That thing that the ladies are having, that charcuterie. Yeah. You know, I don't think you ought to be able to use a word if you can't spell it. Just kidding. Anyway, the ladies' fellowship, whatever it is that they're doing, is Thursday, June 27th from 6 to 8. Cost is $15 per person. And so, ladies, enjoy that, okay? Pray for us. Falls Creek is coming up. Youth camp, July 1 through 5. That means we're going to be, actually it's July 1 through 6, but we are taking a group. And also this year we are taking First Garnet Road Baptist Church in Tulsa. They have kind of fallen in their membership, and so they're not able to acquire a cabin of their own, so we had some space, and so they're going to be going with us. So you pray that we'll be able to bond with that church and with their kids and everything like that. So that's coming up. You can still help us by picking up one of the food envelopes out there in the hallway. And if you are interested, I think we're okay, but if you're interested in a Falls Creek scholarship, you can just write that across the an envelope and give that if you would like. And I also want to express my appreciation to you for the Wednesday night that I was here, but Manuel Diosis was here, the missionary to the Philippines, and I don't have that figure, I don't think, in front of me, but I believe we gave over $5,000. Is that what it was, Phil, Thomas? I didn't hear you, and I don't care. Some of you will have to ask about that. That's it, I'm not being rude to him, but it was a Southern Baptist Convention joke that happened while we were there. So anyway, $6,000. Sorry, 518. Okay, so thank you all for giving to that, and that will go to his ministry. And it was beautiful to see his family. His son sang during the service, and he preached a wonderful message. And that is the second time that they have been here at our church. And so anyway, you pray for them. Again, as he shared with us that Wednesday night, their visas expire, I think, sometime in either September or October, somewhere in that time frame. And they're trying to come into our country legally, and they're having issues being able to do that. So pray for his family, and as they go back to the Philippines to do their work there, okay? All right. Let me share some prayer requests, and then we will go ahead and pray and then get into our Bible study tonight. Minnie Blevins, who has been in the hospital after breaking her hip, is now at Grand Villa, and they are taking her through rehab. So you pray for Minnie, and pray that everything would go well in regards to that. She's been in good spirits when we've seen her there at the hospital, and I have yet to see her at the Grand Villa. But anyway, just pray for her. Also, Carl Branch, who is a friend of Vera Mae's, fell, and the cancer has returned, and so we want to pray for Carl Branch tonight. Also, Sherry Fries, she was here this past Sunday, and if you saw her, you saw the effects of the fall that she had, and she doesn't look good because of the fall. She had a lot of bruising and everything, so just pray that everything will go well in her healing. We also want to remember Brother Thomas and his family and the death of his dad, Bob Nelson. And they're going to be away this weekend taking care of some family matters. So just pray for Thomas and his family. Obviously, in recent months, have lost his mother as well. So pray for them as a family. We've been asked to pray for Sly Patrick, which is the brother of Christy Kearns. I've never heard of this, viral arthritis in the joints. So anyway, pray for that situation. And for those of you who know about our free clinic here that we have on Thursdays, the coordinator of that, Pat Sorrells, passed away. She had, I believe, a stomach cancer. And anyway, that is a blow to that ministry. So you pray for the Christian Clinic volunteers and pray that everything would continue to go. There are some really good things and important things that are happening through that ministry, and we're able to have it here at our church. So pray for that situation. And then some friends of Vera Mae, Terry and Derla Wise, some health issues. And oh, that's the one. Okay. Yeah, I remember that. Okay. All right. And then down, I want you to, we got to see Charlene Pritchard just a little bit today. She came by the church office. Her white count is so low that it's just not good for her to be out because she is susceptible to infections and things. And she is going back to MD Anderson, and they are trying to approve her for a stem cell transplant. And if that happens, it is very, very an involved situation, would require her staying down there for an extended period of time and things like that. So just pray for Charlene tonight, if you would. Pray that her white count will come back up, and pray that she will continue. She's been a trooper through all of this, and so just continue to pray for her, if you would, please. Judy Ace and her family and the death of her sister. I want to remember them. Bertha Oriol tonight, let's remember her with her health. She is home healing. And Alan Bruns, Alan and Cheryl, certainly want to continue to pray for them tonight in our prayers. And Danny Knight. Let's see, the Schilt family are going to be here probably in about 9 or 10 days. They hope to be here in our service on the 30th. Is that right? 30th of June. And so we will probably get to see them, just and maybe they'll be able to share some things. But he will be preaching. Chris will be preaching later on, and so we're going to have some opportunities to minister to them. They are not going to be living here. They're going to be in Tulsa, But we are going to be able to minister to them as our IMB missionaries. So we're going to be giving you some information as we get closer to all of that. So let's remember them tonight in our prayers as they make it come home from Malawi, okay? All right. That's all I pretty much want to share with you. Let's remember our servicemen and women that you see there. Let's remember our country tonight. And somebody shared with me a good thing that happened today. In Louisiana, the Ten Commandments is going to be posted in all of the schools based on a law that has been now, they were removed in 1980. The problem is when we removed them, we never replaced them with anything. And so what I appreciated about, even though the decision happened when we were in Maysville, Oklahoma in the early 1990s, I had a elementary principal that was a member of our church. His name was Gary Reynolds. And Gary came up to, one day I went into the school there and was visiting with him, and I noticed the Ten Commandments posted. And I said, well, you're not a very good law-abiding citizen, are you? And I was teasing him. And he said, nope, they're going to stay right there. Somebody's going to have to come in here and remove them, because I believe that's where they should be. And he was a member of our church. So I appreciate that kind of response. But anyway, I guarantee you there's going to be a federal judge out there somewhere that's going to block it in some way, shape, or fashion. So there'll be a challenge to it. But anyway, it is good to see when our culture does turn toward the Lord. So let's pray for these tonight. I failed to mention our very dear friend because I just went right over her name, Vicki Pittman. She is a pastor's wife there in Payton, Oklahoma. They are getting ready to call in hospice. They do not believe she will last much longer than 6 months. Her cancer has metastasized. It's just not a good situation. But she is ready to meet the Lord. She has two daughters and multiple grandchildren, and she is trying to make the best of that. And she has a very loving husband. He is pastor there at Payton. We've been dear friends for 25 years or so, Terry Pittman. So just remember Vicki in your prayers tonight, if you would, okay? So let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, Lord, the name that is above every name. And Father, I pray for these prayer requests tonight. Father, there are some tremendous needs. There are situations that sometimes we're not even aware of. There are things behind the scenes. We see the name and we see maybe a little bit of a description of what they're going through. But Father, many times we don't know what they're going through. And so Father, I lift up these individuals tonight, and I lift up their families. And Father, I pray that you'd give them the strength, and I pray that you'd give them the wisdom. And Father, more than anything, I pray that you would help them to have the patience of Job in spite of the circumstances, that Lord, they would listen to you and that they would be able to handle whatever comes their way. And Father, remind us tonight that this is not our home. Our home as believers is in heaven. That is eternity. That is where we will spend forever and ever with you, your Son, the Holy Spirit, and Father, with fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. But Lord, it's hard because we as humans, we don't know anything else but the life that you have given us here on this earth. So Father, I do lift up these individuals, those who have lost loved ones, those who are going through difficult health issues. I especially want to lift up Charlene Pritchard to you tonight. Father, I pray that you would just move in her life. Be the great physician. Lord, let her know through her faith that you are there with her. And Lord, you have a purpose in all this. We sometimes don't understand it, but Lord, we trust you tonight. And I lift up Terry and Vicki Pittman to you tonight. Lord, they've been dear friends. Vicki has been a faithful pastor's wife. She loves you. She loves her family. So, Father, again, we don't always understand why things happen the way they do, but we also know that there is something better that is planned for us. I pray for our country tonight. I pray for our culture. Lord, we can have a victory like this down in Louisiana, but Lord, we know full well that Satan is going to rear his ugly head, and he's going to try to do something else to distract. And so, Father, I pray that you would not only help us in those areas, but Father, help us to be witnesses of you, to not in any way, shape, or form mislead people and by our lifestyle confuse anyone, but help us to, Father, be diligent and be willing to follow you in whatever you ask of us. Tonight, Lord, in a very real way, we're going to be talking about the fact that you're coming again and what we should be doing in light of that. So, Father, thank you for your word. Lord, we want to be true to it. We do not want to do anything that would do a disservice to your precious word, your infallible and inerrant word, and help us to, in our relationship with you, to live by the word of God. We give you praise, honor, and glory tonight, and it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. If you have your Bibles tonight, James chapter 5, last time I was here, the last time we were in James, we were in the first six verses of James, and we were talking about the misuse of riches and how people can allow the love for money. And remember, the Bible says it's not money that's the root of all sorts of evil, but it is the love for it. And so, really, James gets after his congregation there very very hard, I would say. I mean, he really gets after them. And now he kind of turns to an exhortation type message, and we're going to look at verses 7 through 11, and we're going to talk about the fact Jesus is coming. Be motivated. Jesus is coming. Be motivated by that, okay? And so we'll talk a little bit about that tonight. Now, on our vacation to Alaska, the cruise ship docked at Ketchikan, Alaska there the one day. We got off, and as I shared a little bit partly in this story, us boys, there was three of us, were waiting on the girls to get off the ship, and because the platform was long and everything, we were sitting there at the visitor center, and there were two men who were sitting right across from us. And they each one had a political hat. One was different, but they basically said the same thing. And so I just was trying to engage in a conversation there. I said, "Are you having any trouble with that hat that you have on there?" And they said, "No, not really." And so we began to talk, and immediately this one particular man began to share how, man, you know, our world is just going downhill. We need a change. We need a spiritual revival and stuff like that. And come to find out, he was a member of a Baptist church in Illinois, and he was in a quartet, and they sang a four men quartet. And so anyway, he began to talk, and then the subject came up. Well, you know, we're in the last days. Jesus is coming. So we had an opportunity to share our faith, and we had an opportunity to listen to a gentleman share his faith, and the fact that all of us that were there in the conversation, we believe that Jesus is coming back. I hope that you believe that, folks, because it is one of the basic doctrines of our faith that is not negotiable. If you say that Jesus is not coming back, then you're saying you don't believe the Bible. And so that is one of the basic tenets of our faith. We do believe in a visible return of Christ. Now, we Baptists don't agree on how he's coming or when he's coming, okay? But that's okay. Well, actually, we probably are pretty close on how he's coming. But as far as when he's coming, that's certainly can be debatable. So we believe that Jesus is coming back. Now, have you thought much about if Jesus were to come back? Are you ready? I had an opportunity today to share with an individual that statement. I said, if Jesus were to come back by the end of this day, would you be ready to meet the Lord? And that individual told me, I'm not sure. So we began to share and we began to talk a little bit. And so by the end of the conversation, this individual was able to share with me that because of what I had shared about the scripture and things, that they had an assurance that they had trusted in Christ in their life, but that they just needed to be more committed to the Lord, okay? So I think all of us, if we stop and think about it, if Jesus were coming back, are we ready to meet him? If you're not a believer, obviously you're not ready. If you are a believer, there may be some things that you have not gotten settled with the Lord, and so that's something we need. So here's the question. Are we motivated based on the fact that Jesus is coming back? Does it do anything to your life? Does it cause you to witness more? Does it cause you to read your Bible more? Does it cause you to be more faithful to church services and to the Lord and to his ministry? Does it have any effect on you whatsoever? So could it be that maybe you believe that Jesus is coming back, but it's just not affecting you? It's not motivating you the way it should. So we want to look at that tonight. In James chapter 5, beginning in verse 7, I'm reading from the New American Standard, and here is what the Word of God says. James speaking to us through the power of the Holy Spirit. He says, therefore be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. The farmer waits for the precious produce of the soil, being patient about it, until it gets early and late rains. You too be patient. Strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is near. Now, he's already said it twice now there, folks. Coming of the Lord, okay? Verse 9. Do not complain, brethren, against one another, so that you yourselves may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing right at the door. As an example, brethren, of suffering and patience, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. We count those blessed who have endured. You have heard of the endurance of Job and have seen the outcome of the Lord's dealings, that the Lord is full of compassion and is merciful. Okay? So, if we are not careful tonight, we can get down and be discouraged at what is happening in the world. It seems like Satan is having a heyday. It seems like he has been kind of set loose to be able to do whatever he wants. But we know that God is in control, and we know that God is going to, he's going to allow him to do certain things. But in the end, Jesus is coming back, and God, the righteous judge, is going to right the wrongs that are in this world. So, the challenge is not to be discouraged. And I think that's why James is encouraging his readers to be motivated, because of the fact that Jesus is coming back. There is an end to this situation in our world, and I think James is basically saying, don't lose hope. Know that Christ is coming back. Be motivated to live a life of holiness. Be motivated to share with others. Be motivated to actually, you know, be positive. I'm not talking about a false positive or something like that, but I'm talking about folks, we are on the winning side. If you know Jesus Christ, then you can have an eternal hope, a hope that is enduring and lasting, and that should challenge your faith, and that should also encourage you. We shouldn't be depressed. We shouldn't be living our lives and hanging our heads as though, oh, poor, poor, pitiful me. Okay? So let's look at the text for a moment. Let's see what he's saying here to us, okay? So under the backdrop that Jesus is coming, or the return of Christ. So here we go. In verse 7 and the first part of verse 8, number 1, the return of Christ should lead us to be patient. Notice what he says there in verse 7. Therefore, be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. The farmer waits for the precious produce of the soil, being patient about it until it gets the early and late rains. You too, be patient. Sounds to me like he's trying to tell us to be patient. He's using the same word. In fact, there'll be two different words we'll look at tonight. He is saying to be patient until the Lord's return. In the previous passage here in chapter 5, James had instructed about the impatience of the greedy people who were obsessed with money and worldly possessions. What they wanted it, and they wanted it now. We have this microwave mentality sometimes, folks. Listen, I get frustrated. You know, if the microwave at our house ever goes out, we're in trouble. Because when I want a piece of pizza that is cold in the icebox, I want it warm, I want it now. And you're the same way. The microwave is a wonderful invention, I guess. But anyway, we sometimes are impatient. James uses a word here for patience that some have translated to be long-suffering, but actually this word comes from a root word that means long-tempered. What we're going to see in this passage tonight, with the word in verse 11 that says endurance, we're going to see that he's talking about here in dealing with relationships. In verse 11, the endurance dealing with pressure of circumstances that come your way. Job, he had all these things happen to him. But here in verse 7, he is using a terminology here that means long-tempered, okay? And so I think what he's saying to us as believers, he's saying we should not have short fuses when it comes to our brothers and sisters in Christ. He's talking about the brother. He says, brethren, there in verse 7, therefore be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. His readers had gone through sufferings and trials. There had been dissension in the group. He's already told us that in here in the book of James, chapter 4. What is the source of your quarrels and conflict? So they've been having some problems, okay? And so he's saying, be long-tempered and get along with your fellow believers. Some of you have heard me tell this story before, but it's worth repeating. Man in a grocery store has a screaming child in the basket. He's pushing down, getting groceries. This child is throwing a wall-eyed fit. Now, that's my terminology that I got from my parents. I don't know that I gave one of those wall-eyed fits in my life. I probably did. But anyway, it just so happens that this little boy's name was Jimmy. So he's pushing the cart down the aisle, and it's saying, he's going, it's okay, Jimmy, it'll be all right, don't worry, keep your cool, just hang on there. And there was a woman that noticed that, and she came up to him, and she said, I want to compliment you for your patience with your child, Jimmy. He said, lady, my name is Jimmy, not the child. Now, in the last part of verse 7, James uses an illustration that all of them could certainly relate to, because there was an agricultural presence there. The patience of a farmer waiting on the fruit of his crops, whatever that might be. Folks, you don't get fruit overnight. You don't get the produce, however you want to call the term, there is a waiting period. There's early rains as well as late rains. The early rains, we have been in farming communities at our first church. There was cotton and wheat, and the cotton crop. Many times, if they weren't careful, the rains would come and they'd have to replant. So what they were hoping for was that they get that cotton planted and get a firm standing. And then they wanted the rains to come, because you're out there in southwest Oklahoma and sometimes the rains don't come very often. And so they wanted the early rains, and then they wanted those crops obviously to grow, and then they would want that late rain to help them before they started harvesting the crop, okay? So We have a song that we sing it from time to time. It's a chorus by Maranatha Praise. It says, "In His time, He makes all things beautiful. In His time," and folks, that is what God does for us. We need to be patient. We need to understand that God works on His timetable and not your timetable and not my timetable. Okay. And it's going to be worth it one day when Jesus returns. Think about it this way. Every heartache will be removed. Every fear eliminated. Every tear dried. Every sickness healed. Hate will be overcome by love. Rejection will be triumphed by intimacy with our God. Evil will be slaughtered by holiness. Jesus will crush the head of Satan forever, and we will dwell in paradise with Jesus and those who follow with us. There's a passage of scripture in Romans 8:18 that says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us." Folks, watch your perspective. If we're not careful, we can allow the circumstances in our lives to completely warp how we're looking at things. Jesus is coming back. We need to be patient. Secondly, the return of Christ should lead us to be prepared. Okay? Last part of verse 8 and into verse 9. It says there, I'll get there in a minute. "Strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is near. Do not complain, brethren, against one another, so that you yourselves may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing right at the door." So because Jesus is coming back, we should not only be patient, but we also should be prepared. And in verse 8, he reminds them to be patient, and then he tells them, notice the phrase there, "strengthen your heart until the Lord returns." Now, that word "strengthen" here means to turn resolutely in a certain direction. We are not to look right or left, but we are to fix our focus on the fact that Jesus is coming back. And folks, we are going to be held accountable even as believers for what we have done with our Christian life. And those, obviously, who do not know Christ, this judge is right around the corner. He's right at the door. And folks, one of these days, the dead will be judged, okay? And so he challenges us to be resolute, focus on the Lord. Now, I don't believe that means to go overboard when it comes to the return of Christ. There are some people, you know, you can go overboard on anything, okay? I don't care what it is. You can go overboard on many different subjects in life. And so sometimes people get just enamored with the second coming of Christ, and it's all about the second coming. It's all about the return, pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib. Are you a dispensationalist? Are you an amillennialist? Are you premillennialist? Are you no millennialist? I'm a panmillennialist. I don't know what you all believe. I believe it'll all pan out in the end. But we're not. I just don't feel like we should argue over the fact of some of the particulars. Let's just concentrate on the fact that Jesus is coming back. We're to keep our eyes on him. What does Hebrews tell us? "Therefore, since we have such a great cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and sin which so easily entangles us. Let us run with endurance." There's that word endurance that we're going to see in verse 11. "The race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus." That means to resolutely fix on Jesus, not just gaze at him, but put your focus on him. "Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." Folks, we need to be resolute. We need to be prepared, because James says here that the return of the Lord is near. There is I was reading one commentator, he was talking about a man that he knew who was a doctor, and he had on his office wall just a plaque that had two words, "perhaps today." Perhaps today. That we'll put it in perspective. I read a story this past week about Dwight D. Eisenhower, who was our president in the 1950s. As you know, he was also instrumental in D-Day and there in 1944. But when Dwight Eisenhower was president, he was vacationing in Denver one year. He saw an article of in a local paper about a six-year-old boy by the name of Paul Haley who was dying of cancer. And the boy had expressed a wish to see the president of the United States. So in one of those gestures that has been remembered much more carefully than any speech that a president might make, the president decided to grant the boy's wish. So on a Sunday morning in August, the presidential limousine pulled outside the Haley home and out stepped the president. He walked up to the door and knocked. Mr. Donald Haley opened the door wearing blue jeans, an old shirt, and a day's growth of beard. Standing behind him was his son, Paul. What a shock. The president said, "Paul, I understand that you wanted to see me. I'm glad I could pay you a visit." So Eisenhower shook hands with the boy, picked him up, took him out to see the presidential limousine. They talked for a while, and then Eisenhower left. The Haleys and their neighbors talked about the kind deed that President Eisenhower had done for them, and they never forgot what they had done. But there was one man that was not happy. It was Mr. Haley. You see, when the president came, he had an old shirt on, he had jeans on, he had an unshaven face. What a way to meet a president of the United States. He wasn't ready. Folks, Jesus is coming one of these days. Are we prepared for when he comes? So we need to remember that. Well, there's one final thing that I believe that's in this passage. Well, it also says there, let me just comment that it talks about strengthening your heart for the coming of the Lord is near. It talks about do not complain, brethren, against one another. So, see, there's the practical side of that. He's saying, hey, focus on the Lord and his return, and if you do that, you won't get so focused on problems around you. Okay, not saying that we're not to deal with problems, but sometimes problems can really mount up and they can really turn our perspective. Okay, so Jesus is coming back. We need to be patient and we need to be prepared. And again, if Jesus came back before this Bible study ended, would you be ready? Would you need to do anything whatsoever to change? Would you need to go, hey, I need to go take care of a relationship. I need to confess some sin to the Lord. Whatever it may be, make sure, folks, that you are ready and prepared to meet him. The third and final thing in verses 10 and 11 is the return of Christ should lead us to be persistent, okay? Because Jesus is coming back, we need not only to be patient, prepared, but we need to be persistent. Now, James uses another word here in verses 10 and 11, and let's look at it again. He said, as an example, brethren, of suffering and patience. Now, that word patience is the same word up in verses 7 and 8. Take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. We count those blessed who endured. Now, there's the word endured. The New American Standard uses the same word or uses the different word, and they translate it. Some have translated patience, but they translate it endurance or the verb endured, okay? That is the idea of getting through difficulties. It's not necessarily personal situations as the one up front. Long-tempered meant to handle your relationships with people. This is talking about the stress that can come about in your life through circumstances, things that happen. Sometimes there's just not enough hours in the day. Sometimes you've got a boss that's hanging over your head and he's wanting you to have things done by a certain time. And so this is the idea of long suffering, dealing with the circumstances in life, okay? It means to stay put. The word has the idea to stay put where you are and not be tempted to run away. There is that idea behind that word. Folks, have you heard of people who, when things get going tough, they just leave? They just run away. Or as Festus would say, get the heck out of Dodge on gun smoke. But we're not supposed to do that, okay? We're supposed to hang in there, okay? And then James uses an example here. He talks about there in verse 10, he talks about the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Listen, think of the Old Testament prophets and what they were sharing, the message that God wanted them to proclaim, thus saith the Lord. Most of it was the thus saith the Lord, the forthtelling. But some was the predicted element, the foretelling, where they would be predicting things. But can you imagine some of the things that they had to share? Sometimes what they shared took time for those things to happen. They didn't just automatically happen, okay? And so there was time involved. And so he talks about the, having that patience or endurance of the prophets. And then in verse 11, we count those blessed who endured. There's that word again, long-suffering. You have heard of the endurance of Job and have seen the outcome of the Lord's dealings, that the Lord is full of compassion and is merciful. Folks, you've heard the term having the patience of Job. What about Job? Well, he stayed in touch with himself. Job's wife suggested suicide when all of the trouble affected him and his family. He had friends that turned on him. But God gave him an inner peace through the storms. He was willing to accept what had happened. And folks, it was a great loss. Some of us would not have been able to handle that situation. I read about a boy who was blind at birth. He told a friend one day he was looking at it from a positive perspective. He said, "At least I'm not afraid of the dark." Now, folks, that's a young man that is within himself and understands what's going on. There was a mother who was waiting for a plumber to fix a leak that had flooded the basement of their home. And he didn't get there on time. And so the plumber apologized for being delayed because there was water everywhere in that basement. And she said, "No worries. I decided to teach my kids how to swim while you were delayed." Now, folks, that's an individual that takes advantage of the situation. Not, "Whoa, whoa, pitiful me," but "I'm going to take an advantage. I'm going to turn this thing from a bad situation to a good situation." Job also stayed in touch with God. He did not blame God or leave. He trusted in the Lord. And John 16:33 reminds us, Jesus saying, "These things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have tribulation, but take courage, I have overcome the world." Now, folks, that word tribulation there is the word for taking a grape and squishing it in your hands. That's the word for trouble. In this world, you will have stressful times. In this world, you are going to have times when things don't go well. What do? Do you bail out on God? Or do you trust him through the situation and let him have his way in your life? Some of you know my one of my favorite illustrations is Horatio Spafford, who wrote the hymn, "It Is Well." Can you imagine losing your four daughters in a ship accident? His wife was saved, but the four were drowned or killed. And he was in Chicago. They were over in England. Well, his wife sent back a cable basically saying, "Saved alone." The girls had perished. So when he went over on the ship later on, because of business, he had been delayed. He asked the captain, when they got to the point where the accident, I believe there's two ships that had collided, he asked if he could be told. And so he went out on the bow of the ship. And that is when he wrote these words: "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Folks, it's one thing to say that when everything is going right, but to lose your family, four daughters, to be able to share that. Let me ask you something. When trouble comes your way, are you persistent in leaning on the Lord, or do you find yourself wanting to leave? That's behind the word here, endurance, okay, in verses 10 and in 11. They endured, the endurance of Job, and have seen the outcome of the Lord's dealings. God ended up blessing Job, okay? He ended up taking that whole nightmare and turning it around. So let's remember, Jesus is coming back. Do you believe that tonight? Does it motivate you in any way, shape, or form? It should. I challenge you to look at it from a perspective that James has his readers to look at it. Be patient. Be prepared. And be persistent in your walk with the Lord. Jesus is coming. Live every day ready. Live every day ready. And I believe if we will do that, it will change our perspective. And folks, I believe it will help us to see the need to share with others about Christ. It will convince us that we need to make sure our families know the Lord. You know, once your children get out of your home, they are responsible for, obviously, their own lives and things like that. They're going to stand before God themselves. But you still have an influence, Dad. You still have an influence, Mom. Grandparents, you still have an influence. Don't let the enemy discourage you from always saying a word for the Lord. Always making a difference, okay? Be patient. Be prepared. Be persistent, okay? So let's do that tonight. And that's the word to you from the Lord. I believe that's everything that I want to share with you tonight. Just continue to pray for these that we have mentioned tonight. And I pray that just really lift up Charlene Pritchard tonight, if you would, as she goes back. And till the Lord allows us to return this coming Sunday. And by the way, we are having the Lord's Supper this coming Sunday morning, so we will be gearing our service around the Lord's Supper. Brother Matt will be back with us, and so hope that you will be here and be ready to be a part of that as well. Okay? All right, let's stand. We'll be dismissed. If you would, please fellowship with one another before you go. It's still light out there. It doesn't get dark for a little bit. So hang in there and enjoy fellowship together. Let's be dismissed in a word of prayer. Father, thank you for the fact that you have made provision for us. Your Son, Jesus, came the first time to seek and save that which was lost, provide salvation. He comes a second time to rule and to reign, to gather his church, the called out ones. So, Father, help us to be ready. Encourage us in our walk with you. And, Father, help us tonight to make a difference in our home, to make a difference in our families. And, Lord, with the people that we run around with the people that we see, Lord, I pray that they would know that we are truly believers, that we believe that Jesus is coming back. In spite of what is going on in our world today, we have a positive outlook because we know that Jesus is coming back. So, Father, thank you for that. Go with us as we leave this place this evening. Be with our kids who are out at GOVA this week, our younger children. Father, prepare our students as they go to Falls Creek in the coming days. Thank you, Father, for those who help us in making sure that we're able to have these camps. And so, Father, we love you and we thank you. And we look forward to this coming Sunday to celebrate the fact that you have shed your precious your blood, and you have given your body so that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Father, we love you and we thank you and we praise you. And it's in Christ's name that we do pray. Amen. You are dismissed.